turn to page 612. 612, He Keeps Me Singing. Y'all ought to smile or you're going to scare me. There, that's better. Mothers. Yes, ma'am.
452.
452. Beneath the cross of Jesus. I don't know this one. Do you? I bet I know it after you play it. Okay. Give us a little. I'm not going to admit when I don't think I know it anymore, because most of the time after I hear it played, oh yeah, I know that one. All right, page 26. Great is thy faithfulness.
Thank you.
151. Maybe today, 151.
This evening, and we're so thankful for the good Mother's Day service the Lord gave us this morning. And we had a number of visiting guests, and we're thankful for each one that came. And I wanted to put before you a couple of things tonight. I want to take about, it's probably going to take me about 10 minutes right now to accomplish what I feel like we need to accomplish before we go back to our hymns. So I'm going to put all of our orchestra just on hold while we just take a few minutes. I want to impress upon us the importance of our music conference that's coming up. And by one of the ways I want to do that is by putting a challenge in front of us for prayer. Whenever you do anything for God, you expect that Satan will oppose. We need you to pray with us about this music conference coming up this month, the 27th to 29th. Now, it's a great blessing from my perspective to have the Randalls in our church and also to have their his father-in-law be able to come and speak. And I wanted to give you some kind of whet your appetite for some of the things that are going to be addressed during the music conference. We're going to have such, Lord willing, we'll have such topics as a New Testament philosophy of Christian music presented, and then two musical choices every Christian ought to make, that even a child can make. There's going to be a matter on the very first gospel rock concert. We're going to be going through a lot of teaching. There's going to be Brother Ives giving his testimony of how God delivered him from rock and roll music. It'll be his salvation testimony. We're going to set this up so that we'll have services on a Friday night and a Saturday night and all day Sunday. The Friday and Saturday, we're inviting other churches to come to. And so we need you to pray with us that we will have a great widespread impact on teaching and clarifying an issue which the world is confused. Now, we have a missionary in Papua New Guinea. I've mentioned maybe before that Tim and Becca Lewis are missionaries we support in Papua New Guinea. And I've asked him, do the people in Papua New Guinea, can they discern between godly music and ungodly? He said, Pastor, when they get saved, they know the difference. And he said, the issue of music is clear as can be in Papua New Guinea. Until American Christianity brought in a Christian radio station and under the name of Jesus Christ taught Christian rock music just by playing it. And he said, since that day, the music issue has been confused in Papua New Guinea. Now, I believe that there is a great need for clear Bible teaching on this. If I can, I would say it this way, that the world we live in, they just revel in living against God, doing that which is right in their own eyes. And I believe that probably an illustration I'd like to put before you tonight is of the artist Michelangelo. Now, I'm not talking about artwork. We're talking the whole realm of music and the arts. Michelangelo, famous for painting what? The Sistine Chapel. A sodomite who used his sodomite partners as models for sculptures and paintings. A perverse man who was very well accepted by the church in his day. He borrowed from Greek paganism, which should not surprise you. You know that in the Greek games there was a lot of nakedness. And if you've been so unfortunate as to see any pictures of Michelangelo's works, maybe even his statue of David. And it is of a David in a setting of having just slain Goliath, and David is completely without clothing and without shame. And it's morally perverse. It's morally abhorrent. It's against the word of God. It's unlawful. It's ungodly. It's unbiblical. And there's this parading of nakedness that we could say is part of the Greek culture. It's also something that a sodomite used in his sculpture. And it's misleading about the character of David, because David was not an immoral man at that point. And then also, it incites perverse thinking when we see statues like that. And it's horrible to have to guard your eyes in when you're considering David and Goliath. And so I want to say that this is all throughout the arts in our day. I grew up in a home, my mom was an artist. She would buy Frederick Remington books of the West. And oh, we love the Western pictures, and mom loves horses. But mom would get art books, and I've told you that I noticed that there were a lot of people in mom's art books that all had the same black magic marker clothing. They all wore black magic marker clothing, and I remember seeing that one time and thought, these people, they're just very boring dressers. Boring dressers. Mom was shielding us in the house from having anything in our house that would be wrong. And yet what the world calls excellence in its portrayal of form, and excellence in its portrayal of artistic beauty, is still often immoral. And because we are in a day where we're pilgrims, we're strangers, but we pick up dirt on our feet, and we very easily get our thinking skewed by the philosophy of this world just because Hollywood is pumping it out. And so it's very easy for us to have a wrong understanding. You understand that the music and the arts of a culture, well, they come from so many directions. I was thinking that probably most of the hymns, a lot of the hymns in our hymn book, came out of more of a revival culture than what we are experiencing today. Just like there is a contemporary Christianity, part of the contemporary worldly Christianity, that's part of a false revival. It is a charismatic, someone said a charismatic chaos. It's part of a name it, claim it, gospel, health and wealth, and this kind of a charismatic, it really is a distortion of the truth. It has produced a music that is false in its teaching, and it's also distorting, so it's hard to tell right from wrong. And you see it in Papua New Guinea. So there's a desperate need for clarity in Bible teaching. I was talking to Brother Randall a while back, and I was lamenting, lamenting the fact that I wish I had more music philosophy in my background, biblical music philosophy. And when I was at Pensacola, do any of you have other fields that you wish you knew more about? So if you could, you studied other areas. So when I was in college, I was not going to be an evangelist. I knew that, but I took all the evangelism seminar classes I could because I wanted to learn about those guys. Who is this evangelist? And then I also took all the music classes I could so I could learn music philosophy. And I was talking to Brother Randall about how so many Christian colleges are not teaching biblical musical philosophy of what the Bible says, how to discern right from wrong. So that doesn't help us.
But I want to put before you one passage, just one passage in my short message before the message. 1 Corinthians 14. You're probably familiar with 1 Corinthians 14. It's speaking of languages, and music is a language. And it's speaking about how language needs to be distinct and clear. And we would say that musical language, music needs to be distinct and clear. 1 Corinthians 14, 6. Now, brethren, if I come unto you speaking with tongues, what shall I profit you except I shall speak to you either by revelation or by knowledge or by prophesying or by doctrine? And even things without life-giving sound, whether pipe or harp, except they give a distinction in the sounds, how shall it be known what is piped or harped? Distinction. It's that word for a certain sound, not confused, not disorganized, very clearly perceived. For if the trumpet give an uncertain sound, who shall prepare himself to the battle? So likewise ye, except ye utter by the tongue words easy to be understood, how shall it be known what is spoken? For ye shall speak into the air. So one of the great desires of Pastor Lang is that our music be easy to be understood, plainly, clearly, spiritually.
Amen.
Plainly.
Amen.
Clearly.
Amen.
No question, unquestionably. And I've had people say about our church, well, you have a very simple church in your song service. It's plainly, clearly, I believe, spiritual. That's our goal. To have a distinction in the sounds, except ye utter by the tongue words easy to be understood. Unfortunately, there's a lot of confusion on this issue, isn't there? And so I believe we're privileged to have Brother Randall address this issue and his father-in-law who traveled for how many years? 20 to 30 years teaching a distinction in biblical music from godly and ungodly music. Brother Ives, it's an honor to be able to have him. Brother Ives visited Brother Ballinger's church years ago when Brother Ballinger was pastor. About 20 years?
More than that.
So this is a privilege and we're excited, but I'm going to ask you to pray some things very, very particularly. I would ask you, would you pray? You have notes. Would you take a couple notes down? I am praying that God will give all present ears to hear. All present ears to hear Bible truth. Ears to hear Bible truth. That's very, very important. You know that if a child doesn't have ears to hear, there's not a lot you can do with them. And if an adult doesn't have ears to hear, there's nothing we can do with them. So my prayer is that God will give all present ears to hear Bible truth. Second, that we will have a heart to conform to Bible truth. If we're just hearers only and not doers, what's the point? A heart to conform to Bible truth. I mean willingness to change. Willingness to change. Number three, that God will help us to, number three, have a supreme desire to glorify God and crucify self. Did you know that if I have a supreme desire to glorify God and crucify self, that makes the music issue a lot easier? It just does. Because we live in a world where everybody wants to say, well, that's just my music. That's the way I do it, and that is the way Nadab and Abihu did it and died by it, doing it their way. So a supreme desire to glorify God, these are very simplistic prayer requests, and I think it's best to keep it that. Lord, would you help us to all to have ears to hear Bible truth, a heart to conform to Bible truth, meaning willingness to change, a supreme desire to glorify God and to crucify self. This last one's last two are important. Lord, help us to have a stronger church unified around Bible truth. Music splits. Did you know that? Music divides. Churches split over music all the time. May God give us a stronger church unified under Bible truth. And then last of all, I'm praying God will give us spiritual discernment to discern good from evil. Spiritual discernment to, you could say, distinguish good from evil. Spiritual discernment. Can we pray for those things? I'm going to lead us right now. I just wanted a few minutes to put before us how critical it is in a day where there's so many people saying, this is beautiful, it's artistic, it is choreographed, it is perfect. What, perfect what? Pornography? Perfect what? Perfect illicit against God's authority? Perfect unlawfulness? No. Let's ask, would you join me in prayer now as I just pray very briefly through these things. Father, oh Lord, it is my heart's desire that if there's anything in me or in our church that needs to change, that you would have a free hand to do so. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for purchasing us by the blood of your Son. Would you help us to keep in mind that we're not our own, so our music is not our own. Lord, I'm asking that you give me, give us, give all present ears to hear Bible truth. We believe you've never stuttered. We believe you always speak clearly. It's us who have the problem. So would you help us to have ears to hear Bible truth and a heart to conform? May we conform to the image of Christ and to the truths of your word. I ask for a willingness, a heart that's willing to change. Lord, music is a tender issue. Music is a touchy issue. People, we just talk about our music, but Lord, would you help us to be willing to change to whatever you say? I'm asking that you'd give us a great and supreme desire, an overriding desire, Lord, to glorify you and to crucify us. Crucify self, to let you have your will and your way in our lives. And Father, I pray you'd strengthen our church with all strength and unity, that we would have discernment to be able to distinguish right from wrong in this area of music. Thank you for the privilege to be able to have Bible teachers on music in who are well able and capable of teaching biblical philosophy, your philosophy of music. I pray it would be extremely profitable. And Lord, I ask that you'd help the church people, your people here tonight, to covenant together, to commit to you, to pray between now and this music conference, that it would be extremely impacting, glorifying to you, helping us, our children, our children's children, to be able to better discern right from wrong for your glory. And we ask that our children would stay in the right paths. We ask the grandchildren of this church, Lord, that you'd help this pioneer work, that it would continue for generations in the truth if your Son does not come and intervene in that time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right, let's turn one more time to 345. We'll end our song service on Grace Greater Than Our Sin. 345.
Thank you.
Isaiah chapter 53, just for a moment of your time. Isaiah 53 this evening. Isaiah chapter 53. Probably one of my favorite chapters in all the scriptures is Isaiah chapter 53, and let's read several verses here. We're going to go back to chapter 52 and begin in verse 13. Isaiah 52, verse 13. The Bible says, "Behold, my servant," speaking of Messiah, Jesus Christ, "shall deal prudently. He shall be exalted and extolled and be very high. As many as were astonied at thee, his visage was so marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. So shall he sprinkle many nations, and the kings shall shut their mouths at him, for that which had not been told them shall they see, and that which they had not heard shall they consider." And then it comes back to the Jew. "Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him." There's a commentary writer from years ago by the name of Barron. Barron has, I believe, the greatest commentary I've ever read on Isaiah 53. And it's at this point that Barron points out that when it says, "When we," speaking of Israel, "shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him." And he believes that at that point going forward, the cry of Israel, that they shall look upon him whom they have pierced and they shall weep. And here's what we'll say: when they see him, no beauty that they'll desire him. Israel's going to cry out when all Israel is saved, "He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not," speaking of their generations beforehand, when he came unto his own, and his own received him not. "Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all." Must have been 12 or 13 years ago, right before I started keeping record of every message that I preached, when I preached it, so that I had a record of where I came from and where I'm going. But I went through Isaiah chapter 52, the verses we just read in Isaiah 53. And it was the second time I'd preached through it. Once it went on the church, and then I got so much more preaching here going through it. And God made this text very, very important to me. But there were some things that when you go by them and you study through a text, you don't get to. And this is one of those nuggets that is in the sidelines that I never pulled out, and I passed by it and saw it, and I thought, you know, maybe someday I'll come back to this. So I'd like to bring before you tonight a message about sheep. All we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. We're compared to sheep, aren't we? Well, Israel was there, and so are we. It's interesting that Jesus became a man so that he could die for men and women. And in the same passage that it says, "All we like sheep have gone astray," Jesus is compared to a sheep too. In fact, I didn't get to our text yet. It's verse 7, the next verse.
He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth.
Have you ever seen a picture of someone, and when you saw the picture, you said, that picture is perfect. That captures their personality. I wonder if you ever seen a picture like that. When you saw the picture, you said, that's them. That's them. I have a couple pictures of Rebecca that in that picture, it just captures who she is. Maybe you have a favorite picture of your spouse or a favorite picture of someone who's a friend of yours. Or maybe as you think of people and you're having fun, you say, that is them. It's a blank expression. Or maybe you say, that is such an ornery picture. They look so full of mischief. That is Elijah. That is him. That's him. Or maybe it's someone who's stubborn and you just look at the picture and you go, whoa, that accentuates that characteristic. Or maybe someone who's just joyful and you see a picture of them and it's just a great big joyful smile and you say, that's them. That's them to a T. How perfect was the Old Testament picture when it spoke of us as sheep? As sheep. And yet to talk of Jesus as a sheep, as a lamb, it doesn't seem right. It sounds condescending. If the Holy Spirit himself had not chosen this to represent Jesus as well, and yet Jesus became one of us, how perfect a picture could it be? Christ became a man. And so we have a picture that wasn't the first time it was used in the Bible. How many other Passover lambs were there before Isaiah 53? And we even see the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. In Revelation 5, the Lamb in the midst of the throne. But I want to bring before you tonight a message on chastening, chastisement. I was in a Bible study with some men this past week, and the question came up of what is chastisement? And chastisement, what is it? It's a form of discipline, isn't it? Would you turn over very quickly to Hebrews chapter 12? I'd like you to read a New Testament understanding of this idea of chastening and enduring chastening. Brother Ray, Brother Jim is sick. Could you get me a drink of water? He's my normal fellow who always has a cup of water up here, and you don't ever use it until you don't have it. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 5. And ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. If ye endure chastening, God dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the Father chasteneth not? But if ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are ye bastards and not sons. Furthermore, we've had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? For they, that's our earthly father, verily for a few days, I felt like my spankings went longer than that, chastened us after their own pleasure, but he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. Now no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. I'm back in Isaiah chapter 53. If you're a child of God, God chastens you. If you're a child of God, God steps up and disciplines you at times. Thank you so much, Brother Ray. And it's absolutely because he loves us that he does chasten us. There's an expression in our language. We say, boy, I got fleeced. I got fleeced. What does that mean? I got taken.
I got taken advantage of. I lost out big time. I got taken. But I would have you know that there is an expression in Isaiah 53 that says that Jesus was as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. I'd like to speak, number one, on the long-suffering of Jesus Christ under chastening. The long-suffering of Jesus Christ as a sheep before her shearers is dumb. Now, let's think of a sheep. When a sheep is shorn, what does it lose? It loses its wool, its fleece. It loses its fleece. So he was shorn of some things. Can you think of some things that Jesus Christ lost between coming to earth and going to the cross that he had taken from him? Anyone? You can just say it out. His glory, made himself of no reputation. What else? What? He was not up in heaven with his Father. That's right, the right hand of the Father. Could you say comfort? Lost some comforts, lost his honor, lost his good name. Could you say he lost his life? Lost his life itself. And under his shearers, he was silent. So, because as a boy I read a book, and as I got older I've read it again, and because I have children I've heard it read again, and I have the story in my mind of something called Farmer Boy. Farmer Boy. Now, what is that? That was one of the writings of Laura Ingalls Wilder. Farmer Boy, Almanzo, and his dad when they would shear sheep. And Almanzo was the one that once his brothers and his dad and the friends would shear the sheep. It was his job to take the sheep up to another level, or take the fleece up to another level. And so the story is told about how Almanzo, well, he said, his dad, they were joking with him, and they saying, well, we're going to beat you. And he said, oh, no, you're not. He said, yes, we are. Well, of course, they were going to beat him because they shear and take the fleece off, and then they give the fleece to Almanzo, and then Almanzo takes it away. So obviously, he's going to be the one who loses. He's got to be, because the last sheep has to be shorn before he can have the fleece. And he said, oh, no, I'm not. I'm not going to lose. And at lunchtime, when they all go to lunch, he stays out and takes a live sheep and takes it up and puts it with the fleece. And so they get done and they say, we won, we beat you. And he said, no, you didn't. You did not. Oh, yes, we did. And they're joking with him. He said, oh, no, I'm the one who won. And right then, the sheep that's up with all the fleeces up there starts bleeding. And they said, oh, he didn't lose. He fooled us. Well, I wonder, have any of you ever been in a place where you have shorn sheep? Anyone been in a place like that? Okay, Sarah has. The only one? Oh, you have? Okay. So two? So Brother Ross has? Oh, Dr. Johnson, you've shorn sheep. Have you gotten to do it, or you've been there? You've seen it done. Ah, seen it done. It's one of those things, some of you are saying, oh, well, I've seen it on TV. So it's one of those things where you've seen the sheep shearers, those metal things, these prongs that kind of bend toward each other, and it's a fascinating thing to see. I saw it years ago, video, and it's interesting, but the Bible says Jesus Christ, speaking of his long suffering, it says he was as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. Not an angry word. Not a loud word. Pilate says in Mark 15, answerest thou nothing? Behold how many things they witness against thee. Herod was disappointed because he expected to see some great miracle. His words were very few and far between. I think very important. Pilate said unto him, art thou a king then? And Jesus answered, thou sayest that I am a king. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. Very important words. I'd like you to consider, he did not open his mouth against his enemies. Didn't open his mouth against his enemies. Did they slander him? No reply. Did they spit on him? No answer. Did false witnesses rise up against him? Nothing in response. Did they smite him with the palms of their hands? Did they smack him with the palms of their hands? Folks, even in the Old Testament, when a donkey was smote, he talked. But Jesus was struck with palms of his hand, people's hands. No answer. Do you realize what he could have done? Do you remember a man by the name of Herod who was talking in great words, oration of how great he was, and all of a sudden he was eaten of what? He was eaten of worms. God could have just looked at the people smacking him and just looked at them, and they would have been eaten with worms from the inside out. I mean, Golgotha could have opened and swallowed them all up alive. It wouldn't have been the first time the ground had opened and swallowed people up. But he opened not his mouth. You talk about long-suffering under chastisement. Chastisement. You say, Pastor, this was more than chastisement in this. This was the cross. Yes, but even in our passage, you've already read, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. He opened not his mouth against his adversaries. He didn't open his mouth against you or me. Do you remember a story of a man in the Old Testament that was supposed to circumcise his boy and he didn't? And then his wife went and circumcised his boy, and his wife looked at her husband and said, I'm just telling you what she said, thou art a bloody husband unto me. Thou art a bloody husband unto me. Jesus could have looked at us and said, you are a costly spouse. You bring me to shame. You are a reproach unto me. But you see, he'd already counted the cost. And in despising the shame, he endured the cross for the joy that was set before him. Is there not long suffering in Jesus when he's chastened? I wonder if Jesus, why he didn't look at us and say, it's not worth it. I love them with an everlasting love, and I know what their love's going to look like. Their love for me is going to be cold, often. It's going to be half-hearted. It's a miserable return for what I'm going to put into this. Do you realize? But he didn't speak one word against his enemies, and he didn't speak a word against any of us. Having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. He didn't speak a word. He didn't speak a word against his father. Maybe when you first hear that, you might say, yes, he did. He said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? But that wasn't a complaint. That was grieving. That was grieving. Those are the things he did not do. When he opened not his mouth, he didn't speak a word against his enemies. He didn't speak a word against you and me. You talk about long suffering. But I'll tell you what he did. He was completely submitted to the will of his Father. There's a verse that talks about bind the sacrifice under the horns of the altar. Jesus didn't need to be bound to the altar. I come to do thy will, O God. Willing to suffer, willing to be spat upon. There's an old writer, ancient writer, Philo Judaeus, who says this about sheep. He said, woolly rams laden with thick fleeces put themselves into the shepherd's hand to have their wool shorn. Did you hear? They put themselves into the shepherd's hand. They put themselves. Being thus accustomed to pay their yearly tribute to man, their king by nature. The sheep stands in a silent, inclining posture
unconstrained under the hand of the shearer. These things may appear strange to those who do not know the docility of the sheep, but they are true. Imagine a sheep willingly putting himself into the hands of the shepherd for this. Submissive. And I want to take this correlation on long suffering under chastening, and I'd like to extend it to us. How do you respond when you're chastened by God? I think it's an important message to deliver around the time when we focus on music. Are you willing to be chastened by God or not? Do you have a heart that submits to God, or do we talk back? As a sheep before her shears, he opened not his mouth. I want to ask if you can see yourself in the same type of long-suffering of Christ. No, you're not a real sheep. No, you're not going to be fleeced this year. You don't have to worry about shears getting too close to your hide. You don't have to worry about being nicked. You're not going to be offered up at the temple this year. But Romans 8 does say, for thy sake we're killed all the day long, we're accounted as sheep for the slaughter. That means we suffer. In Matthew 10, the Bible says Jesus sends us forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. And one of the young men, I think Philip, just preached recently on a Sunday night a week ago. He preached a message from 2 Timothy 4 where Paul said he was ready to be offered up. It sounds like a sheep on a sacrifice, on an altar. And just as a sheep is taken by the shearer and his wool is all cut off, sometimes the Lord cuts us back. Remember, do you remember, maybe some of you might, Dr. Bill Rice preached a message. I think some of you might have heard it on a July 4th, a couple of July 4ths ago. He said that he was talking about how it's good to see young people keep their children in line. And he said it just did me good one time to see a parent get down on a child's face. He said, I was in public and the parent got right in that child's face and said, if you don't straighten up, I'm gonna trim your hedges. And Dr. Bill said, I don't even know what trimming your hedges looks like in a child. The child probably didn't know what trimming your hedges looked like, but the child knew this. He's in trouble. Well, you know what? There comes times when God trims our hedges. When he removes the comforts. We could say it in a New Testament sense, when he prunes us back. Not fun. I wish when it's my turn, I hope that I'm willing. I hope I don't talk back to God. Hope I don't mouth off. Jesus was as a sheep before her shearers is dumb. I'm afraid I open my mouth a great deal. And there's not much that a sheep can do for a master unless it comes time to the slaughter day when it's food, but a sheep can, while it's living, give every year fleece, wool, can give something. And it's interesting. Here comes the shearer and takes up the sheep. Can you imagine this? Some of you love animals. So the thought of taking a sheep and taking its fleece off is not something you appreciate. It's not something that you would have an easy time doing. But a shepherd who knows what he's doing can cut and cut and cut away and can do it without hurting the sheep at all. You know when the sheep is probably most likely to be hurt? Yes. When it's what? When it squirms, when it's resisting, when it's fighting. That's when a sheep is likely to get cut. A sheep is most likely to get hurt when he's resisting the trimming back. There may come a time when God pulls out some shears. I was talking to a man after the service this morning. He said it was a hard message. Not praising your wife. But
because he's lost his. I think how hard it must be to lose a spouse you love so much. Those are big shears. I think of people who've lost a child, and your child isn't with you, or maybe the Lord won't let you have children. It's hard. And it's like he's taken something away. Or maybe you think of a property that you lose. Or maybe you had good health and you used to be strong. Used to be nothing wrong with you. And you were in the prime of your health. But it's like God has cut back your fleece. Like he's taken it off. And it hurts. Your health is not what it was. Think of someone who loses his good name, and it's not his fault. Shearing time. How hard it is to lose something and lay yourself at the feet of the Lord Jesus and say, take anything. The Lord giveth, and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Are you like me? There's sometimes when the Lord puts a text on my heart like this one, I get nervous. Lord, if I preach this, are you going to make me demonstrate it? I don't know. Do you think thoughts like that? I think thoughts like, Lord, if I submit to this, are you going to check and see if I'm really being real? But God's a good God. And he's a good shepherd. And he can be trusted. And really, when you come down to it, the yearly shearing of a sheep, it's for the benefit of the shepherd, but it's also for the benefit of the sheep. And if the sheep goes too long without shearing, summer becomes really uncomfortable, and briars, and the sheep's fleece becomes overloaded and troubled. Yes, it's for the glory of God, but it's also for our benefit. There's many things we would like to keep, but they will hurt us. There's many things that it seems good, but we'd like to keep a hold of it. Remember the illustration of Pastor Shetler and his little boy, Luke? I think it was Luke. I remember it was Ben or Luke. I can't remember. And Pastor Shetler said he was in his house, and he saw Ben had something up at his mouth, and he was eating, and as soon as his dad made eye contact, Ben went, and Pastor Shetler said, well, I'm going to say it's Ben because I can't remember, Ben, what is that you've got in your hand? And he just backed up, wouldn't show him, and he walked right down the hallway of his house saying, Ben, give it here. What are you eating, Ben? Show me what's in your hand. And when they got to the back of the wall and he bumped up against the wall, he said, you give me your hand. And Ben held it out with his hand tight as a little fist. He did not want to give up to his daddy what he did not want to be fleeced from or didn't want to lose. And he held it out. His dad said, open your hand. What have you been eating? And he said, when he opened his hand, he saw there was half of a dead cockroach. What happened to the other half? Oh, that's what you're, oh, gross, Ben, that's gross. What are you doing with that in your hand? Is that what you were doing? Oh, Ben, you know, and there's things that we hold on to. We don't want to let them go. You know what? There are blessings from God that sometimes God takes away. And I think of one in the Old Testament where God said, you can use it for today, but if you have it for tomorrow, it will breed worms. What a great blessing. Manna, bread from heaven, as honey wafers. I always think of vanilla wafers. But there's these honey wafers that taste so good, like Snickers bars. And this is delicious. But it's only for today. And you can't hold on to it tomorrow. I've thought before, wouldn't it have been something if there were actually, if the wilderness that they walked through had been like Minnesota, the land of 10,000 lakes, they would have had, if they kept their dough till the next day and it bred worms, they would have had wormy dough balls. They would have had great fishing stuff for all the lakes through the desert. And yet, what? God said, that blessing, I will take it away tomorrow. It's only good for today. You know what? There are things that we hold on to that we don't want to let go of. I'm just telling you, having a house over our head is a gift from God. Children are an heritage of the Lord. Thank God. The Bible says, enjoy the wife of your youth. Enjoy your husband. Enjoy your wife. Enjoy the fruit of your labor. It's part of the gift of God. You know, a sheep, when it loses its fleece, there comes a time it has to have the wool off. It reminds me that there comes a day that we will all lose everything that we have that we hold in our hands here. Nothing here is ours except God. Even our children are on loan to us. All his gifts are on lease. All our possessions are just brief favors. Some of you have less, some of you have more. But it's all a brief favor from God. And so as a sheep yields up its wool, all of us will lose our houses and land someday. But God never takes away but that he gives better. And the shepherd is so good. He never does anything to hurt us. And the shepherd is so wise. God is not a shepherd who strips us of our wool right before winter. He takes off the wool when it comes summertime. His timing is perfect. His way is best. It's always at the right time. And there's new wool coming. It's wonderful to think that when they stopped eating manna, when was it? When they had the new corn of the land. Or the old corn of the land. They stopped having that rock with the water that followed them. That rock was Christ. When? Well, when they had the Jordan. And I want to encourage you, we've just gone through so many things in brief tonight. I've tried to just demonstrate that chastening or shearing time glorifies God. And it's good for us. And God always sends trials at the right time. And it's so much better to submit to God's shearing than to fight it and be nicked, to have blood on the shears. And I want to encourage you to be still. Be still. And know that he is God. We don't know what tomorrow holds, do we? Be still and know that he is God. As a sheep before her shears is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. I was amazed, I was shocked, I was horrified when I heard that Mrs. Earlene James had a rooster that attacked her a while back and spurred her. Leg was hurt, bleeding badly. And it just confirmed in my mind that livestock is not from God. No, it confirmed in my heart if I have chickens, if I have chicken and eggs someday, I'm going to take a stick with me. Well, if I walk into you're not going to find me walking into a chicken house. First, let's make that point first. But if I have to, I'm taking something with me to take care of that rooster. And if it flies at me, brother, we're going to play baseball and knock that thing right out of the park. It's going to go sailing, Brother James. Well, I just as I think about this, I don't know if roosters, do roosters peck at a stick if you do that? I know dogs, if you take a dog and you got a dog that's coming at you, if you'll stay away, stay back, it'd bite the stick. You know what? Whatever it is that God's put in your life, God's behind it. I know that's a hard thing to say because we don't want to blame God for any of our troubles, but God intends all things for good. God is conforming us to his image, And if it would be far better for me to say, Lord, I don't know why, I don't understand what you're doing, but it's you, and so it's enough. I yield, I submit, I'm not going to talk back. As a sheep before her shearers is dumb, I want to be long-suffering, and I want to learn in patience from this, what you're trying to teach me. I don't want to be biting at the stick. I want to just look at the master. And I want to ask you, is fretting, is groaning, is worrying going to help you through any of the trials of life? Then lie passively in the hand of God and submit yourself whatever comes. I want to be more quiet at heart. I want to be more calmly surrendered. I want to be as a sheep before my shearer is dumb. And I think that means saying, Lord, do what you want, when you want, as you want. Because you know best. And I don't believe we're too far away from where we ought to be in conformity to the image of Christ. If when Christ brings chastening, we are as a sheep before our shearers dumb. Not my will, not my way, not my music. Whatever you want. And I believe that kind of spirit will always glorify the shepherd. I cannot promise you that you won't lose your fleece, but I can promise you you'll be better being in the hand of God than anywhere else. Father in heaven, thank you for the great passage of Isaiah 53 of Jesus Christ, complete 100% submission to you, his Father. Thank you that he opened not his mouth, that he didn't fight his way screaming through the cross. Thank you that he was fully surrendered to you. Thank you that he didn't talk back to enemies. He didn't talk bad about us. He could have. But thank you for his sweet spirit under chastening. Lord, I ask that you'd help us tonight to make a decision that you can take what you will, when you will. We want to be completely submitted to you. And Father, I pray that you'd give us a spirit of rest, that we would be still and know that our shepherd is God. The Lord is our shepherd. How many would just say, that's a hard prayer, Pastor Lang, saying, Lord, you can take what you will, when you will, as you will. But the plain truth is, I belong to God, and he's a good shepherd, so I trust myself to him. And I want to have that rest of heart that says, be still and know that I am God. I want to be as a sheep before my shearer, my shepherd, is dumb. How many would say the Lord spoke to my heart when it comes to chastening, that I be still? That I be still. Would you slip my hand up in the air? That I be still. Surrendered. Have your way, Lord. You have my best interest in mind. You're going to glorify yourself best if the sheep doesn't fight, squirm. So, Lord, help me to be still. Let's stand to our feet. It is good for sheep to surrender. Would you surrender all to him afresh and anew tonight and say, Lord, I want to be still and recognize that you're a good shepherd and all I am and all I have is yours. And I want to be as a sheep before her shearer is dumb. You're the good shepherd. I trust you. Would you take a few minutes with your shepherd tonight and say, Lord, you're my shepherd. I surrender to you. Whatever you want. As the piano plays. Thank you.
We rest in you, our shield and our defender. We rest in you that you're our good shepherd, and the shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. With such a shepherd as your son, and such a father as you, I thank you that we have no need of worry, resting, being still before you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You're dismissed.